Like the One Ring of Power in Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, deoxyribonucleic acid, DNA, is the master molecule of every cell. It contains vital information that gets passed on to each successive generation. It coordinates the making of itself as well as other molecules. If it is changed slightly, serious consequences may result, and if it is destroyed beyond repair, the cell simply dies. Virtually every cell in your body contains DNA, or the genetic code that makes you, you. DNA carries the instructions for the development, growth, reproduction, and functioning of all life. Differences in the genetic code are the reason why one person has blue eyes rather than brown, why some people are susceptible to certain diseases, why birds only have two wings, and why giraffes have long necks. Amazingly, if all of the DNA in the human body was unraveled, it would reach to the sun and back more than 300 times. DNA is so important that the United States government has spent enormous amounts of money to unravel the sequence of DNA in the human genome in hopes of understanding and finding cures for many genetic diseases. Finally, from the DNA of one cell, we can clone an animal, a plant, or perhaps even a human being. But what is DNA? Where is it found? What makes it so special? And how does it work? In this video, we will look deep into the structure of DNA and explain how it makes itself and how it determines all of your traits. But first, I'd like you to subscribe to the channel and don't forget to leave a comment and probably ring that bell for more interesting videos. So, DNA is a self-replicating material inside every single cell of your body. Think of it like a recipe book for cooking up a human being from scratch. But not just any human being, specifically you. Since your DNA is unique to you, with the exception of any clones you forgot to mention, or twins, which are nature's clones. Inside the recipe book are various chapters, which are like chromosomes. Humans have 46 of those, half of which come from your mother, and half from your father. When you lay them all out in pairs, you get your karyotype. If chromosomes are chapters, then genes are individual recipes in each chapter. While it's possible to have single gene traits, like whether or not you have long eyelashes or brown eyes, many traits are the result of multiple gene interactions, such as your intelligence or your coat color, if you're a golden retriever. Take a moment to visualize the process of thousands of genes coiling into 46 chromosomes, forming your complete set of DNA. Starting at the smallest scale, we have genes contained in long stretches of double helix. The helix is then wound around molecules called histones to form neat little packages called nucleosomes. The condensing strand coils and twists further into increasingly large bundles to form supercoiled chromatin fibers. And the supercoils fold into loops which wind even further until we have a chromosome. Collectively, all of this is referred to as DNA, with a single molecule of DNA being a chromosome. This bundling and coiling is an incredibly fine-tuned process, with different coiling styles in different cells, appropriate to local gene expression. In other words, while every cell in your body contains the genes that code for eye color, the DNA in iris cells is coiled in such a way as to leave the pigment genes in more accessible parts of the chromosome, ready for expression. And this coiling process happens a lot. Every time a cell in your body divides, which is every few hours or days, depending on the cell's job, all 46 chromosomes necessarily uncoil into vast stretches of DNA, exposing all the inside ladder rungs to replicate, then coil back up in a highly specific manner to rest as neat little packages once again. So, we tend to think of DNA as a jigsaw puzzle. Except there are only 6 different shapes and 18 billion pieces overall. The 6 shapes to consider are the DNA bases, adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, and the DNA backbone, sugar rings, and phosphate groups. Because of their chemical structure and physical attractions, the bases and backbone are compelled to join together like a ladder. Since molecules are rule-bound, we find this beautiful order emerging out of apparent chaos. Imagine yourself in a landscape with a train track stretching out behind you and in front of you, all the way into the distance. The longitudinal rails are like the sugar phosphate backbone of DNA. while the latitudinal sleepers are like the complementary base pairs, always matching as A equals T and G equals C. As you walk along the train track, you can count off the sleepers for miles and miles. The average gene is about 27,000 base pairs long, although some are as long as 2 million base pairs, which is quite a lot of train track. If you were to examine your entire genome, you would have to walk along 3 billion sleepers. Surprisingly, not every sleeper is considered to be useful, coding DNA. At least, in humans, only 2% of our DNA actually codes for proteins, which is the whole purpose of DNA. The other 98%, called non-coding DNA or junk DNA, is a mixed bag of knowns and unknowns. Now we have the structural intricacies covered. How does DNA work? Recall that DNA is like a cookbook, chromosomes are like individual chapters, and genes are like individual recipes, most of which don't actually make pie or soup or apple crumble, but are relics redundant to your current meal plan. In this analogy, who's the cook? Who's mixing the ingredients? And what do they make? This is called gene expression, and it's happening all the time in your body. Genes are expressed on demand, and there's a great deal of variety going on during rapid growth phases, like embryonic development and puberty. But it's also essential for bog-standard daily living too, such as producing insulin to unlock your cells and allow them to take up sugar from your food. Such responses are regulated on a real-time basis, underpinning the life-sustaining nature of your DNA. Gene expression takes place in three stages, known as the central dogma, because it's very important to how DNA works. The first stage is transcription, where the helical DNA unwinds and copies itself into a single-stranded molecule called RNA. This RNA stuff is pretty similar to DNA, with some key molecular differences, such as all the thymine bases being converted into uracil. This stage is like taking a photocopy of a recipe to work with. Imagine your kitchen is messy and you often set things on fire, and you want to keep your very important recipe book super nice and clean for future use. Especially seeing as you like to cook thousands of times a day, and there is no way to buy a new cookbook if you ruin this one. During transcription, a large protein molecule called RNA polymerase works its way along the DNA helix, teasing apart the two strands with the help of its enzyme pals. The single RNA strand, which is the photocopy in this example, is then assembled from free-floating DNA bases in the surrounding goo, attracted to their complementary bases without much fuss. It's all very elegant. The second stage is called RNA processing, where the new strand of RNA goes through some modifications. Here, various little enzymes come along and attach a cap and tail to the strand of RNA, which determine how long it should live. Other enzymes chop up non-coding base pair sequences of the gene and leave behind only about 1,200 out of 27,000 base pairs to be expressed in a process known as alternative splicing. It means that a single gene can be expressed in numerous different ways, which is super efficient. It's ironic then that so much of DNA is non-coding junk, which is super inefficient. This is, The third stage of gene expression is called translation, because there's a change of language from bases to amino acids. The spliced RNA strand pops out of the cell nucleus and into the cell cytoplasm. Here, it attaches to a ribosome, a molecular complex that reads the base pair sequence in groups of three, called codons. The transfer RNA molecules have an anticodon on one end and its amino acid counterpart on the other. Thus, the ribosome translates the sequence of codons into amino acids. What emerges is a long chain of amino acids, also known as a polypeptide, which is the foundation of a protein. It's purple, because proteins are always purple in biology textbooks. I don't know who started that, but it's a nice bit of synesthesia to help you learn your molecular groupings. Incidentally, if you aren't using colors in your notes, it's never too late to start. Several amino acid chains fall together to form a protein, which is the ultimate product of gene expression. This is how DNA works, moment to moment, inside every cell in your body.